الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله.
In brief, that is the Islamic theory of the original sin. It is not inherited. The Christians say it's inherited, we say it is not inherited. So at question time, these are all missionaries, Christian missionaries. They're trained. So one guy stands up and says, Mr. Didat, even if this child was born out of wedlock, means the man and the woman had committed zina, adultery, fornication. Out of marriage, they had sex and they produced this bastard child, even if the child is a bastard child. I said, yes, even if the child is a bastard child, it is no fault of the child. If there is a law, you punish the man and the woman for committing adultery. But the child is innocent. You can't strangle the child because the child is born bastard, can you? No, it's no fault of the child. I said, the child is innocent. That's the answer. So the guy stands up again and says, Mr. Didat, how can anything good come out of evil? Adultery is evil. Out of that, how can a clean, pure child come out? And my system was, question time, the man asks the question, I'm sitting down and I stand up and I answer the question, and I sit down again. Another guy stands up, asks the question, I stand up to answer. And it took me a little longer to stand up. How can anything good come out of evil? Adultery is evil. How can a pure child come out of that? Out of zina. It took me a few seconds longer, and to me it seems long time. I didn't have the answer. I didn't have the answer. I had the answer. I can speak about physiologically, there's nothing wrong with the child. Psychologically, there's nothing wrong with the child. Ethically, there's nothing wrong with the child. I can speak for an hour on that. But at the end of the hour, the guy can still nod his head and says, Mr. Didat, how can anything good come out of evil? Same place. After 1 hour of exposition of psychology, theology, philosophy, the guy says, no, Mr. Didat, how can anything good come out of evil? So I could see an hour's talk, and still at the end of it, the guy is not satisfied. That's the difficulty. What am I going to say? So Allah, you know, He gives it to you. If you are working for Him, He gives it to you. I didn't have the answer, but it came. I didn't hear anybody talking to me. No Jibril came to me. Anytime you hear that Ahmad Didat saying he's hearing voices, you must know Ahmad Didat needs a psychiatrist. I'm telling you. I said, look, poor fellow, he's going off now. Maybe he's taking some Mandrax pills or whatever, whatnot. He's going off. Then I say, I'm hearing voices. The only voices I hear is your voice when you talk to me. I don't hear any other voices. I didn't hear any voices. But I stood up and I said, you see, eating and talking about the apple, eating an apple in the garden was a great sin. According to you, great sin. For which Adam and Eve were kicked out of the garden. I said, yes. But in contrast to that, compared to that, killing the only begotten Son of God. In a billion years He produced only one. And that son, you go and kill him. That's the most heinous crime you can think of. The greatest sin is to kill God's only son, which He produced in a billion years. He produced only one, and you go and kill him. Compared to eating an apple, what do you think of this, killing God's son? It's the most heinous crime you can think of. And yet, out of that murder of the only begotten Son of God, came the gift of redemption, Jannah, Rahe Najat. I said, you tell me, how can anything good come out of evil? You tell me. Killing God's son? Huh? What an evil compared to eating an apple. If eating an apple is a sin, killing God's only son? Shh. And out of that you say came salvation. That's the only way you can go to heaven. You believe that Christ died for your sins. That's what he is telling you. So out of that murder came this. So out of that murder, how can anything good come out? You tell me. Finish. No. You see, now that thing remains. Because man, that guy made me to think. Like this, yeah, last night I had a dozen questions. The night before, a dozen questions. And tonight, a dozen questions. We ask tomorrow morning, if you ask me what these guys were questioning, I said, I can't remember. Really, I can't remember. Because it's just coming normally. You know, you ask me, and normally the mind surprises. I don't have to really think. Now the Christians have developed new techniques. They come to you, they come to your house. They said, you believe in Jesus? You said, yes. We believe in Jesus. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus. He says, you know, Jesus was one of the mightiest messengers of God. You accept that? He said, of course we accept that. He was one of the mightiest messengers of God. He is a major prophet. He is a Rasul. We accept that. He says, you know, Jesus, he was born miraculously without any male intervention. You believe in that? He said, yes, we believe in that. Everything you got to agree. Look, his plan. He's making this yes. You believe that he was born miraculously? You said yes. Was your Muhammad born like that? He says no. He had a father and a mother. He said yes. That's all. He's called a point. That Jesus is a degree above Muhammad. He didn't say that, but he proved it to you. He says, you know, Jesus is Masihullah. He's the Messiah, translated Christ. You accept that? Yes, we accept that. Your Prophet Muhammad, was he Masihullah? Was he Allah's Messiah? He said, no, he's Rasulullah. But you see, Isa is Rasul and Masih in the Quran. Rasul and Ilabani Israel, Masihu is Ibn Maryam. In your Quran, he's Masih and Rasul. Your Prophet is only Rasul. He said, that is so. Jesus is another degree above Muhammad. He's just proving it to you. He doesn't have to tell you that. He's proved it to you. You know, Jesus, he gave life back to the dead. You say, yes, biiznillah. He said, did Muhammad give life back to the dead, biiznillah? I say, I don't know. I have no knowledge. Jesus is another degree above Muhammad. He's proving it to you. He said, where is Jesus? He says, he's in heaven. He's coming back. I said, yes. Where is your Prophet Muhammad? He said, he's buried in Medina. Perhaps his bones have rotted in the grave. We say, no, he's Hayatul Nabi, he's the living prophet. That's metaphysically, man, spiritually. But physically, maybe his bones have rotted in the grave. You say, maybe. Jesus is another degree above Muhammad. Say, don't you think God had a purpose in doing all that? He does things for nothing. Huh? In a few weeks' time, you're going to make Eid al-Adha, Qurbani. You're going to sacrifice a sheep or a goat or a cow. Without blemish, no fault, ear not cut, horn not broken, not blind, not limping, right? You look for a perfect animal. If God Almighty wants to make a sacrifice for His creation, is He going to look for second best? When you look for the best animal for your qurbani, Allah going to look for second best? You say, no. He's proved it to you, He's second best. Come on, talk now, talk. Talk, man, talk. No, this is not your field. You see, we didn't delve into that. Wallah, this is the simplest things to answer all. I have written a book called Christ in Islam that answers all that. But briefly. The guy said Jesus was born without a father. I said, right, true. He was born miraculously. Muhammad was born like you and me. Accepted. So therefore he's superior to Muhammad. Is that what you're trying to say? I said, yes. Muhammad had a father and mother. Jesus had only a mother. That makes him superior. So, if that's your logic, then the one who's got no father and no mother, Jesus had a mother. Right? He said, yes. But if the guy who got no father and no mother, he's superior to Jesus. He says, no, that's correct. Who can that be? So Allah tells in the Quran, إِنَّ مَسَلَ عِيسَىٰ إِنَّ اللَّهِ كَمَسَلِ آدَمَا. The similitude or the example of Jesus in the sight of Allah is like that of Adam. خَلَقَهُ مِن تُرَابٍ. Allah created him from dust. ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُن فَيَكُونَ. And he said, be, and he was.